Hello, everybody. My name is Jimmy Allison. I'm an Ableton Live certified trainer. And in this video, I'm going to talk about setting up your MIDI. So let's start by getting into Ableton Preferences by going under Live and clicking Preferences. Or if you're on a PC, you'll find it under the Options tab. It's also a good idea to learn the hotkey, Command comma on a Mac and Control comma on a PC. Over on the left side, you'll see a number of tabs. You want to click on the Link MIDI tab. And there's basically three sections. Well, four now that Link is available. Just a quick overview on Link. It allows you to sync multiple devices and computers over a LAN. So on the MIDI setup, you're going to have three sections. You have your control surfaces, then you have your takeover mode, and then you have your MIDI ports. And they're not all the same. Control surfaces are basically things like the push, the APC 40, things that automatically work in Live. You don't have to MIDI map them. You plug them in and you play. And you'll notice I have a number of control surfaces loaded here. And this awesome one called Clifix, which I recommend looking up if you like to make Live do things that it's not supposed to do. Generally, when you plug in a control surface, it'll automatically set itself up. But if it doesn't, what you want to do is click the drop-down menu, locate the controller in this list, and then select the ports that it's connected to. If you do not see the control surface in this list, sometimes with third-party controllers, they're unsupported by Ableton, but there are control surfaces available, like the QNeo. It doesn't ship with Ableton, but if you go to the Keith McMillan website, you can download the control surface scripts for the QNeo. Now for takeover mode. I highly recommend putting takeover mode in value scaling. And basically what takeover mode does, it's about how the controls interact. If, say, on your APC 40, the fader's not in the same place as it is in Ableton, when you move the fader and it's none, the fader will snap to the fader on the APC 40. If it's pickup mode, the fader will not move until the APC 40 fader matches. But value scaling is really cool because the fader in the software will move up or down based on the direction that you move the APC 40 fader, but it'll move slower or faster until their values match. It's the most natural configuration for MIDI controllers. Now let's talk about the MIDI ports. In the MIDI ports, you have the names of all the devices you have plugged into Ableton, and then you have three rows: track, sync, and remote. By default, when you plug in a MIDI controller, track will be enabled. This enables you to play an instrument on a MIDI track. So think of it like you're tracking an instrument, you're playing on a track, you're playing your instrument. But if you want to MIDI map some knobs, like with the launch control, you're going to have to enable remote. Think of remote as like remote control. You're using a knob to remotely control a knob in Ableton Live. The sync box generally does not need to be checked unless you're trying to send MIDI clock information to or from Ableton. And the only reason you would do that is to sync other computers or to sync drum sequencers or things like that, like hardware. But it does tend to jitter and it doesn't work all that awesome. That's what Link is for. Link will lock perfectly if with other Link-enabled devices. I also want to point out that you have input and you have output ports. Input is for information coming into Live, and then output is for Live sending information to something else. Like say, I want to send MIDI information to this ARP Odyssey over here. I have a USB cable plugged into the ARP Odyssey, and I can send notes from Ableton to play the synth over here to my left. It's also really handy if you have hardware workstations. You can create multiple tracks and send on different MIDI channels and play different instruments on the workstation, or for on stage, you can send program change information, change the patches on, say, your, you know, Korg Triton or something like that. And you see when I plug it in, the launch control shows up and remote is enabled because that's the way I configured it. Ableton will remember the last way you configured it when you unplug and replug in the controller. But by default, it will look like this, which isn't very useful for the launch control. So you want to turn off track so that way no information goes into any instruments that are playing, and turn on remote. Now we can close preferences, go up here to the top right and go into MIDI map mode. I can click on a knob to select it and then turn a parameter on the launch control, get out of MIDI map mode, and adjust the parameter. Now here's an example of value scaling. My knob is at about a quarter turn, but in Ableton, it's about 3/4 of the way up. So if I turn the knob up, it'll start moving up, and if I turn it down, it'll start moving down until they match. Very natural. Now, if you want to play an instrument, just go ahead and grab an instrument. I'm going to get a drum rack. And I'm just going to grab this drum and bass future kit. And I want to make sure I select all ends, which by default, that will be the selection. And then I'll be able to play it with my Cue Neo. That's pretty much that. Thanks for watching. My name is Jimmy Allison, Ableton Live Certified Trainer. Go ahead and check out my website, austinabletontutor.com, if you're interested in private one-on-one lessons online or locally in Austin, Texas.